shift in terms of Hindutva politics and the BJP, and this is noticeable particularly around the time of the national election, general elections, and after which Modi came to power. And the main thing I think the shift is in terms of BJP going through sub-caste politics, particularly sub-castes of Dalits and backward castes, the most marginalized poor. And there's also been in terms of the caste itself, you find this, that whole process of differentiation is taking place. Mm-hmm. The way development process is moving, there's also a lot of differentiation taking place within castes and between castes that is taking place. So we see classes, but also it's taking the form of caste and then differentiation is taking place. If you look at UP, they have been, the whole UP election which the BJP conducted is through sub-caste. And it's not just that they suddenly came around the election time. For instance, the BJP was the Home Minister, what's his name? Rajnath Singh. He, in UP, they have been organizing this sub-caste for about 4 years now in some villages. They've been concentrating the RSS. So they have been working, even before the election, they've been preparing for 3-4 years through these sub-caste organizations. And Mayawati was also having an alliance of various castes, sub-caste. But then she was having an alliance also with the Brahmin, which is a small community in there, but a more broader kind of alliance she was forming, you know. And then all her corruption and being in power and not really benefiting all the sections who she took along. So there's a large section of both, even from the Yadavas also, backward caste sections, as well as Dalit sections who actually came towards the BJP in the UP thing. And these were also sections which were earlier not just only with Mayawati, but some were also with the Congress, some of these sections. These sub-caste politics and mobilization, the way the Dalit movement has developed in, say, North India in many parts is that each caste has revived its own history. So if you see, hear Mayawati's speeches when she was chief minister, she will, each of the caste have said that we have our own history. And these are all documented also. A lot of literature has come out in terms of the heroes of their community, the heroines of their community, and what are the stories around them. So there are a lot of local histories which has come as part of Dalit, what you call Dalit movement, you know. Or even backward castes, Yadavas have also got their own stories, you know. And in those stories there are these different heroes and the way you interpret those stories, you know. That is the area where the BJP and all have come in. Stories which are very important because they also in a sense, they are also submerged histories, you know. Of these which have come up, and which you see about Dalit history, what you say, these are all the different kind of history which are coming up. So, in those are the histories also in which they have intervened, you know. So, when for instance, when the Pulaya Maha sabha, I think about some 6, 7, 9, 8 months back, they held a big convention along with the BJP SCST forum in Delhi, in commemoration of Iyengar,
okay.
You know, and they held a big thing in which Kerala, this Pulaya Maha Sabha, one section which has gone to the BJP, they participated over there, you know. And there the RSS brought out 3 booklets of histories,
okay.
Of Dalit histories. They brought out a history of Chamars. Chamars and in which, you know, and some other Dalit communities, Valmikis, and other, they brought out their own history, which that, what is the RSS head, his name, he's written the introduction to
Bhagavad.
I can't recall his name. He has written the introduction to the to the three booklets. You know. And that booklet says, see, as it is, Dalit historians, you know, that Ramnara and Yadav and all have written about all these histories of these communities, about the Valmikis, Chamar, he's written about that untouchable, his book, Ramnara and Yadav. So historians, Dalit, intellectuals have already written also these communities' histories, you know. But these people are bringing out popular booklets, the RSS. You know, Dalit groups and all these subcaste groups are participating in Kerala Pulaya Maha Sabha to rewrite radical histories, and in which they are saying that, for instance, the Valmikis are the people who do the night soil cleaning. So those night soil cleaning, and they feel that, it's when the Muslim invasion came, and they are the ones who brought this caste system, you know. And so a totally very divisive kind of communal kind of history, whereas the Dalit histories which were coming up were popular histories were not at all of this kind.
What is it that make these two distinct? Like the histories that RSS has been writing?
What they do is that they reinvent histories. Just as they reinvented Ayodhya. And then people started saying it's a question of belief, not about whether it happened or not. You know? It's a question of your mind. You think it happened, so it happened. So whether it's true or not, so it becomes part of a belief, you know, not the true history as such. And then you build up on that, you know. So these histories is how they are intervening in all India, you know. And I think if you look at the Garwapsi, you know, I think there's a, which I think Kerala also should very much look into it, is that in Kerala there's this whole, see, one thing the BJP and RSS, I can tell you from Gujarat's experience, where any issue has developed. It might be an issue of land, land displacement. Anywhere there are conflict comes in terms of, there are different interests who are affected in different ways. Just say, for instance, the Adanis took the, they were given land in the Kutch port in Mundra, you know. That affected the fishing community there. And the fishing community is a Muslim community, Wagar community, considered very low in the caste system also, you know. At the same time, it also affected a lot of other sections which were living in that area, small farmers, pastoral community, Kachakar, large pastoral community. So it has, there's a whole range of sections which, say, one displacement can affect, you know. Different interests. Now, there can be a conflict situation. If they play to one interest, you know, and they play, say, okay, for one interest we take care of them, then they divide them, you know. So the Hindutuva, the whole BJP politics, in terms of, they always come in when there's a conflict situation, not, they can create a conflict situation, or where there is this kind of situation where the process itself, economic process and these development interventions are creating that kind of situation, they know how to polarize. You know? So they might take the, say the thing, go through, say the pastoral, and using the religious thing. Pastorals, the Yadavas have their own histories, Krishna is their lord in Gujarat. You know? But there are Muslims also in pastoral communities who have their own, there are Sufi sections also there. There are some Islamic groups also, they have their own, you know, belief systems and all that. So they can create a polarization even within the one particular pastoral community, you know. Like through coming in through this kind of thing. So they have a very different way of functioning in which they enter. So what do social movements should do then? See, rather than, okay, we say it's all the capitalists are coming, one individual industrialists are coming, we need to build a movement which brings all these sections together.
So, isn't
so which is what they've done in Kutch. They formed a huge platform. It was called Zameen Bachao Andolan.
Okay.
Then it has become Zameen Adhikar Andolan. Okay. You know, both one section thought we should. It was first is to save the land, and the second is to save your rights. Mm. Both are there. It was both. So it's sort of, but there's a united group.
Okay. Between castes.
Against Adani. Oh. It's an 8 year, it's about a 10 year old struggle still going on in Kutch.
Oh.
Very strong.
Okay.
They didn't want to call, because this whole thing was just, the land was just given to them, this village, notification acquiring villages. About, I don't know how many villages there were, about 70, 80 villages, land was acquired. They just notified. And then they offer a certain compensation, which is not good enough. Mm-hmm. You know? So what happens in their way of functioning is that the government offers a certain compensation, the farmers, then the private interest who's going to come there says that government is only offering this much, we'll give you this much. You know? So then the private comes and offers a different kind of compensation, and then the government ratifies it, the district administration, those sales, you know. At the zero interest, this is all notified. You know. In fact, Kutch, because of the earthquake, they made it interest-free for a long time, you know.
And it was used.
But actually, it really benefited not the people, it benefited industry, you know. The whole place to corporatize. Kutch is the biggest district in India, largest Muslim population, and very diverse.
Okay.
They're all craft communities, and they all interact with each other. It's a very pluralistic kind of, because they, through craft they interact with each other. You know, they are dependent on each other. So that, they have entered in a very different manner. And they have even created like these private sort of come when the industries come up, and then they hire, it's not local workers who hire, you know. So this whole thing of this land acquisition bill, that whole thing is there, they're stopping development. All the examples show what they have done, and they've set up all these malls and things like that. And even when some, say, small industry or something was set up, very little of local people have got work. You know? Maybe 100 or so in one area. We have done a lot of studies on many villages in Kutch area, where about 40, 50 industries came up post-earthquake.
Okay.
You know, a desert, semi-desert area.
Yeah.
And then you have Narmada water, but suddenly Narmada water decides to reach the area where the industry is. You know. But ordinary people in other areas don't have drinking water from Narmada water. So all these things, the Hindutva politics is much more wider in terms of its linkages. You know. Okay. But in terms of the caste, there is a distinct shift.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely now sub-caste politics. And you will see it in the Bihar elections, what they are doing. The whole negotiations going on with Maji. Now what Nitish Kumar did is also he created a Mahadalit category from the alliance that he built up, and he made it into an official category.
Yeah.
See, if you become an official category, means you're now you can get resources. You know, so it's possible to mobilize people around that category now.
Mm.
So the political process has created a category. And that category now, instead of wanting to be, you say we want to be included, but actually you become exclusive categories, you know. You have to be exclusive categories to be included, you know. So that is the way the capitalist process is taking place in, you know, in the development is taking place in India and in Kerala also.
How can you explain the Kerala?
See, why are all these subcastes coming up, you know? See, now subcaste, the Dalit Christian thing I want to really say, I think in Kerala it's an area of potential It is an area of potential conflict which BJP is really playing in. See, when Modi came to Kerala pre-election and had conversation with 30 caste organizations and also with a section of the Pulaya Maha Sabha, the negotiation, the condition which Pulaya Maha Sabha put was that the Mishra Commission report, which gives reservations to Dalit Christians and Muslims, you have to reject that. Modi agreed. Obviously, he agreed.
Yeah.
One is the electoral conditions, considerations, and the other is also it divides.
Yeah.
And there is a part to that whole thing, and then linked with that is a Garwapsi. See, they have thought it out. Now if you see wherever Garwapsi has taken place, and so I think in Kerala you must see this Garwapsi has taken place, is that if you are, say, a Dalit Christian, very poor, or Dalit Muslim in many areas of India who are very poor, if you come back into your community and caste, then you are like, you can get reservations. By not giving it, by refusing to implement the Mishra Commission report. So in a sense, BJP also is bringing them back into caste.
Yeah.
You know? And then through that caste as part of inclusive Hindutuva agenda. So I think that's a big threat in Kerala. I mean, in the context, everywhere it's there, but I think in the context of Kerala, I think this is a potential conflict area. The other conflict area, I think, in Kerala is also the high range area.
Okay.
See, because there, historically, some sections have, replaced, taken land, So there is a section which many years back has come and taken land, and the landless, those who had land have lost their land, So there are the Dalit section, the Adivasi section, So it's an important, very much a potential area to create a conflict. For Dalit versus Adivasis, Dalit versus other communities. They are very interested in that area. So Dalit versus Christians. So I think these are the potential areas they will definitely intervene. And the way they go through it is through this kind of thing, because on the one hand, there is a whole lot of sections which development, the way Kerala is developing now, there's a lot of like Dalit colonies, Adivasi areas, the starvation going on. So these are the sort of areas where it's just open. Either the democratic forces and left forces come in or they come in. So they're very open field for them to come in. But they work very slowly and steadily. They worked quite slowly, steadily in Trivandrum. They came second.
Yeah.
It's just a big shift. It's huge. Even the left was third in position.
So.
And they're playing caste politics.
Yeah.
See, in everywhere they're playing caste politics.
Mm-hmm.
And if other formations also are playing that caste politics, then the caste exclusive class caste groups, they also continue to grow. So they are an interest group who can negotiate with the state, with the political parties, with various local governments.
So
if the political process is going to keep encouraging
caste,
on the basis of this you are drawing your support, you draw from this rather than breaking it and draw from your attitude, your whole approach is to a larger sort of thing. Instead of this exclusive, if you are also drawing like that caste-based support, then that also increases. And that also increases the space for the Hindutva and BJP to come in.
Yeah, it's very. You were saying that this caste politics.
So,
especially,
how do you democratize? What is the process of democratization of, say, like caste divisions are there? I think that should be a debate. How do you know? I mean, we can't have any blueprints. But there are so many, it's all of different kind of interventions have to be done. You can't have like one thing, you know. But how do you democratize? I mean, why are you not talking about annihilation of caste?
That's true.
See, the very interesting thing in taking place in Gujarat, I think Dalit groups, see, Dalit groups, I think, have been very creative. In the last, since 1990, mid-1990s, I think the most creative, and in terms of the kind of debates, very rich debates, is in these movements, you know. Dalit and environmental, the new social movements have created a lot of them. And one of the things is that, for instance, in Gujarat now, there is some of the Dalit groups over there, they are organizing a lot of support systems for Dalits to be able to pass exams, to get into different kind of professions and all that. And they have an ongoing, very interesting campaign. I was there in April, and among school children, huge campaign. And you know, now this Modi has brought this whole Swachh Bharat campaign. So they have done a campaign, no plastic, no caste. So I think that's a very good, and now school children, and they've gone to so many districts. Gujarat caste system is very strongly entrenched, untouchability. So no plastic, no caste, Just as plastic is harmful, caste is also harmful to society. So I think you need the social movements, left movement also need to think up new slogans and new kind of, which actually sort of cut into these divisions, And the old kind of slogans, it's all getting very mixed up now, People are not able to make out from the language, political language. Everyone is using empowerment. For instance, the women's, everybody is using the word empowerment. Everyone is talking about participation. Everyone is talking about collectives. But all have different politics and different meanings. So we really need to, these meanings that we need to give, we have to also decide what are the meanings we are going to give to these, or are we going to coin new slogans. So I think that's anyway, coming back to the subcaste politics, I think that's the agenda of BJP.
One thing you were saying about was the temple.
What?
The temple as a space. Could you please explain on
that? See, temple is that where Dalits... there is a whole thing about recognition, And temple is actually a public space, So if you are not getting any space, public space, and you feel where the divisions are very strong, if you are acceptable, you are allowed to go to the temple where everybody is getting religious, See, the overall process is Kerala. Religion is religiosity. Religiosity is increasing. If you say to that Pongala, it's all Dalit and backward caste women who are in it. Was that our tradition? Or what was it originally? Now it's all conducted and run by the RSS. Though they may not, you might see all women there, but behind the back, they are the ones who are organizing the whole thing. And women feel, there are all kinds of studies saying women's free space, public space. What is that public space? And you are peaceful for coming out with stories, police women telling their colleagues, you want to go, I'll come and take duty today. You go, we want to go for that. All these kind of shown as though that is some feminist liberation, Whereas we're getting trapped into a kind of different kind of ordering.
One thing you were saying when you were speaking about temple was that the Dalits, they would get all these objects and even then they wouldn't get recognition.
Through these organizations like Pulaya Maha, they are drawing them, and these people umbrella committee, Bulgarian umbrella committee, the temple committees. And the temple committees are all got, they're quite interesting. They'll have BHP in it, the Hindu Manani in it, SNDP will be there, NSS will be there, you know, some Namudri organizations will be there. So, to get drawn into that, and if there are umbrella if there is one big festival, to be able to speak one day, it's very interesting, you know, if you go to some of these temple festivals, one day SNDP person will speak, next day Pulaya Maha Sabha, somebody will address the gathering, third day somebody from NSS. So, somewhere there is some sense that we are sort of there with them, you know. It's just their idea that they think they are not really equal. But they feel a sense of what you call what can you call it, term? There should be some term for it, you know, that presence, politics of presence.
So
then, you know, everybody...
Doesn't capitalism give them the sense of presence?
It's not capitalism as such, it's all this through culture, more through culture.
No, you are saying that these Dalits, they get a lot of objects in their houses, like fridge, like all these things. Yeah. Does that make them feel present?
No, that doesn't make them present. That makes them feel that they are not unequal to the house next door or to some other community next door. If they have this, we also have. Reservation is not only presence or recognition, it's much more, it's a way to move towards removing that disability or whatever what is considered discrimination, you know. To move towards non-discrimination and move towards liberty. It creates a ground for that particular person to move, you know, and also for society. It's not only, reservation is not only meant for Dalits only. It's meant for Dalits in terms of their access to these particular avenues which are close to them, you know. But it is also to make society more pluralistic. Whether it's a government service or educational institutions, it's to make it more pluralistic, you know, and diverse. And that is the idea. It's not, that's what Babasaheb Ambedkar, his idea was that. Not just these becoming sort of thing which can be used to just give nominal presence or used to create your electoral lobby or to bring them into the temples, you know. So politics of presence is just what they are playing is politics of presence, you know, where you are nominally there and not really there. So that is, all of these terms have very different meanings you can give it to it, depending on who's playing those politics. So it's not just you, if you get represented in a committee that you are an equal, you become an equal, you know. Do others accept you and is that process really equal, you know? So those are the things I think going into the temple. So it's creating many of these notional kind of thing as though you are really moving into presence, you know, and recognition, whereas it's the system itself is not really broken, you know, but you are getting all these little niches and it gives the image as though there is a presence, you know, and there is really a move, there is some move forward, but it's not really towards breaking the old system, you know, in which all the discrimination and lack of liberty is based on. That's all I have to say about this. Temple is just one area, but that's an area which BJP is very much... Because caste is integrally linked with Hindu religion. Caste system. So it's just that they are moving from... They're just moving within that sphere in a different context, in a different manner. Those have all got transformed and within that they are still, you know, moving towards that. So I think that's the danger that we need to recognize, that how They can use all these modern structures, you know, and use a modern language of liberation and all that, and get into it. And somewhat, you know, I think I saw that in Kerala, the newspapers, I think they also diffuse, like Garwapsi is a very communal, casteist intervention by the BJP among Dalits and other subordinated castes. It's a very casteist and sort of Hindutuva agenda which is there, Garwapsi. Suddenly you say, if one person moves from one political party to another, this thing comes back, Garwapsi. Media is using that, you know. So in a sense that they are really diffusing the politics of Hindutva, you know, by using all these terms, you know, very loosely.
Yeah.
And everybody starts using it in political speeches. Oh, he has come from this place, Garwapsi. But that real threat which is there in Garwapsi, you know, being able to divide people and create conditions for a conflict. That I think Kerala really needs to note. Because Kerala has been, you know, they have not been able to create that kind of conflict here. So many years they have been working in North Kerala for how many years, RSS? And RSS have been violent in North Kerala. The political violence has its roots in the RSS in North Kerala. And why North Kerala, which has a large Muslim population, they won that, you know, and created that. So they can move, and that is a sort of their agenda. Go into areas which are transforming fast. See, I think that's the way you can say the kind of liberalization process, how they come in. Like areas which are moving fast, transformation is taking place, different kind of dispossession is taking place. Different interests are affected in different ways. Even in one, if one land is acquired in one place, you know, maybe a port or something. And that creates a situation for them to come in because there are competing interests. Resources are scarce. So they can intervene. And that is a potential conflict. So the left and democratic movement have to see that these are the sources that they come to. It's not like directly they are going to a caste organization. They see the whole situation, you know. And then there's a very planned parivar intervention. Different sections of the parivar come in, you know. I don't know who their women's organization is in Kerala right now. But I think they are going through the caste organizations, the women's groups within caste organizations. So I think these are kind of political process and economic process, this is what's happening.
Okay.
So in that context we have to see Hindutva and BJP, you know. They have very, they make interventions very much seeing the context. You know, where you can, if there are conflicts you can polarize. So it's not a movement that in any way can bring together anybody. And particularly India, which is so multi, you know, cultural society. Their politics can never. And combined with the interests of the corporate, you know, and big international capital,